Mr. Manish Gupta, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, thank you very much for inviting me here to speak. I am truly honored. And one of the other reasons I'm truly honored is because I'm in a room full of entrepreneurs just like myself. So in that sense, the only difference between us is my journey may have started three generations ago, right? But fundamentally, we're all the same. We wake up every morning, we take risk. We wake up every morning, we have to deal with challenges. We wake up every morning needing to pay the salaries of the people who we employ. So in that sense, we're all really the same. I want to start by quickly telling you a little bit about just the starting of my journey in our family business. So I graduated from college in 1991 in the US, and I came back to India, and I think many of you will remember that 91 was the year when the country was just in a huge mess. All the reforms that they talked about, the liberalization policies, all came out of that huge mess. And that's what I came back to. And in addition to that, so I came back and started working in October 1991. And in about November, my grandfather got diagnosed with cancer. So my dad was pretty much tied up with hospitals and back and forth. And in early December, they decided to fly him to the US. They left me in charge. So I'd been working now for about 2 months, and I was left in charge. They came back about 2 months later. I still have that same job, so obviously I didn't do a bad job in the 2 months. I didn't burn the whole place down. Right? But, you know, that was really a really hard grounding as far as I was concerned. Because with the country in the mess that it was in, so was the GDP. And when the GDP goes into a tailspin, so do all businesses. And we were in that same situation. So you have assets, you have no cash. I was 22. Our senior finance person would come to me and say, "Sir, we need money." I said, "Dude, you're asking me. What do you want me to do, right?" But you know, you learn through those days, and those, I think, those financial challenges is what has shaped the future. And I'm really, really thankful to those hard times, because I think that is what has truly and completely shaped our approach and philosophy going forward. Today, we are extremely conservative when it comes to our fiscal policy and fiscal discipline. Our company is, I think there are not more than 15 companies in India today which are rated at an A+ or above as a corporate credit rating. We're in that league. We started get our ratings about 6 years ago. Our first year credit rating at an A+ category. So an A+ rating basically, the credit rating is basically something done by an external third-party rating agency who comes and says, what is your ability to repay X amount of money, whatever that money is, right? So if A grade is investment grade, B grade is the next level, and then there's just D. D is default grade, basically. So our first rating was an A+. We got rated for 75 crores, which basically meant that that agency felt that if we borrow up to 75 crores, our ability to repay is exceedingly high. And if you borrow anything more than that, then you know, then it's a little risky situation. As against a rated, total rated capability of 75 crores, our borrowing was 11. That's how conservative we were. Every year subsequently, we've gone ahead and gotten our ratings reworked. And over 6 years, we went from 75 to 150 to 350 to 485. Today, we're rated at an A+, while other developers have gone back and lost their ratings, many of them. I'm very proud of the fact that our organization is rated A+ for 685 crores. Just, thank you. Just a word of caution and like a disclaimer, I will not be able to sleep if our borrowing was anywhere near that. So this is no intent to go out and borrow this kind of money, but it's just a good way of getting a third party to come and assess your balance sheet, understand your capabilities, just so that you have a third-party validation of what you do. One of the corporate philosophies that we follow, and some of you may have seen our hoardings and our new word that we use along with our brand, is called outdo. So I'm going to ask, you know, I'm going to request them to please play a quick video on outdo. It sums up our philosophy much better than I can actually tell you about it. So can we please see that?
This one's for those who are all in for going all out. The ones for whom nothing is enough, even the world sometimes. The ones who care enough and dare enough and put themselves out there enough to try something new. The ones who don't just do. The ones who don't just do because they know that the status quo, though fragile, is agile, and they can change it when they give it a go. To the ones who don't make do, they say take two, they refuse to give up, they refuse to give in, till they give the world something to look up to. Here's to the ones who don't just do, but dare to outdo. Gera, over 45 years of outdoing in real estate.
So I think, thank you. And I do believe that outdo isn't something that's just for our organization or our company. We've just put, you know, stamped it along with our name. But truly, every entrepreneur, we need to outdo. So it's really a message which is for all of us. And we just believe that this is so ingrained in our DNA, in our organization, that we decided to put it out there along with us. So I'm going to just talk a little bit about, you know, about Gera and about our values a little bit, and then go into the main subject which I've been asked to talk about. So like I said, we have an extremely conservative fiscal policy. We're very, very disciplined when it comes to funds. All our projects today are... RERA came along, right? As for the real estate sector, this was a big deal. It's made no difference to us. In fact, today, if I don't sell a single more square foot, right? If I don't sell a single more square foot in our existing projects, the money that is already committed from our customers will finish all projects' construction, take care of interest and overheads and bank repayments for the next 1 year. Zero new sales. We can complete the entire construction. So this is really how fiscally conservative and safe we are, right? When it comes to customer first, we put in a lot of emphasis, a lot of focus as far as the customer is concerned. I am sometimes, I think, too thin-skinned. Customers say something, anybody says something, it bothers me. And I think that's how we all need to be, right? If we start getting bothered by what people are saying, we act on it. It's when we are not bothered, it's when we don't really care, that's when our reputation starts taking a hit, that's when our brand starts going down. I think trust is something that, you know, being in the real estate sector, I've seen this. I can say this now on camera because there's a law of limitation. So in the early days when people would come and pay cash in the real estate sector, nobody would give any receipts and nobody's ever asked for a receipt, and you will not find a single person who said that we gave some money and, you know, there's no account for it. So trust is something that is built up, that our brand is completely built on. Innovation. The 5-year warranty, for example, is one of those things. We started doing the 5-year warranty about 14 years ago now. And I am super proud about the fact that the Real Estate Regulatory Act has made it mandatory for every single project in India now to give a 5-year warranty. So we were well ahead of the game. What we then did is about 3 years ago, we went and created our mobile app for our customers. Now, I believe there are other developers who also have apps to help sell. We didn't do this to help sell. So today, my customers who have a problem with their home, and look, we make homes, okay? These are handmade, these are man-made products. So there are issues with them. Today, a customer can log on to the app, take photographs of his problem, upload his warranty-related issue. He can say, I want somebody to come and fix this at such and such time. Our person will confirm it, go and fix it. We have 99% of all complaints now coming off our app, firstly. Secondly, we reduced our site inspections by 70%. So normally somebody would say, window se leakage hai. What are we going to do? We'll send somebody. To ek baar dekhne jayega. He'll inspect, he'll come back, he'll put in a report. The moment you can see 5 photographs of the problem, now you've got engineering people, you've got quality people, they're capable to diagnose the problem. So 70% of the cases, we reduce the turnaround time, and we just send one person one time to go and fix the problem. So customers satisfied, customers happy. So there's innovation across the board. Our child-centric homes, for example. Innovation happens, so there are basically, and this is like probably the only theory part which I'll tell you about, right? So there's something called, when you go into the market and you ask people, what do you need? And that's about satisfying people's articulated needs. But which survey would you go and do when you find out that people want child-centric homes? Nobody's going to tell you, I want a child-centric home. That's about finding the unarticulated needs. So really, if you want to make, from a business point of view, if you truly want to make the difference, you need to go after the unarticulated needs. But it can't be done without adequate research, without adequate R&D. So focusing on needs is great. Everybody's doing that. Focusing on unarticulated needs is really, to my mind, where the place is to really go out and find a differentiator. So I think there's another video which I want you to see, and this is the only reason I want you to see it again is because a lot of people told me, and a lot of developers from our community told me, man, you have guts to put this video out. So this is a video which I created 1 year ago on the eve of the introduction of the implementation of RERA. And everybody was talking, you know, there were these groups about implementing RERA, there were groups about builder bashing. And I decided to say, you know what, rather than how much can we say about it? So I went out and I said, let me make a video. I put it online. YouTube has about 150,000 views. Facebook got 350,000 views. So it hit about 500,000 views. And I just want to show it to you because it tells you a lot about the courage of what we have as an organization and what we do, and where we are willing to put ourselves out for our beliefs in our product. So can we please play that?
Flat delayed, bad builder. Funds diverted, greedy builder. Greed, whose? Imagine, no greedy politician, no greedy official, no greedy customer. Would the builder's greed be satisfied? A builder wants black money. Yes, he's the bad guy. But what about the landlord who won't sell without cash? And the customer who won't buy without cash? How about the official who won't pass a plan? Not all innocent, all part of the system. A contributory culpability. The face of the building is the face of the builder. The others, all greedy, all conspirators. Faceless, yes, but are they innocent? Flat delayed, bad builder. Funds diverted, greedy builder. The government decided to legislate, an outcome of years of pure hate. Finally, the culprit just won. It's time to hang the builder. What fun. But the corruption continues. Unabated, unchecked, officials unaccountable, untouchable. Never responsible for delays, for hurting the city, the state, the country. For delaying delivery of someone's home. So what about his money, her dreams, his house? His rent, her EMI, their financial burden. Self-doubt, anger, frustration lead to words used with resignation. I wish I hadn't trusted. I wish I hadn't believed. I wish I had consulted. Oh, how I wish. An industry too long considered third rate, a safe haven for all things degenerate. It's time to take out the trash to clean things anew. A golden opportunity, a new mindset, a new approach. A chance to rid the industry of the stain. A time to make a change. If not, many years later, we'll still hear, bad builder, greedy builder, I wish, I wish, I wish.
didn't know what all the fuss was about, but people said, my God, you're talking about politicians, you're talking about officials. I said, it's a day in the life of Rohit, yaar. It's okay. But, you know, unfortunately, in the rest of the country, things continue like this. I think Maharashtra has done a phenomenal job when it comes to the implementation of RERA, just on an aside. Let me then move on to the topic which I was asked to talk about, which is building long-lasting partnerships. Now, for the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about family businesses, but it'll come together because I believe that businesses and partnerships are also similar to family businesses. So can I just get a show of hands here from people who are, how many of you are involved with family businesses? So in your business, you've got son, uncle, somebody or the other from the family. Yeah? And how many of you are involved in partnerships? Okay, so most. So the last lot is basically self-proprietorships. How many? Okay, so there are still a few. So when it comes to proprietorships, I would urge you, while most of what I'm talking about is relationships and so on, please think about yourself in your position with your partners in terms of your customers, in terms of your vendors, and so on. Okay? So I'm a third generation family business entrepreneur, and we're now looking at our fourth generation actually joining the business. So to us, I think longevity of the business is extremely, extremely important. But it's interesting. Forbes did a study of family businesses and found that less than one-third of family businesses go into the second generation, and less than half of those go into the third generation. So by the time you reach the fourth generation, it's virtually, you know, very, very few family businesses are left. And many families set up rules of functioning, right? And they still, these family businesses split. Many partnerships set up rules about how they'll function, yet these partnerships split. And in fact, some of these family businesses have horrible splits, right? In the public, people know about it, it transcends generations, and it's the same with partnerships as well, right? Two people started off as friends, involved in a business, suddenly you want to split, it's a messy affair, people in the friend circle, business circle, everybody's in, you know, in the know of it. This is part of reality. But on the other hand, many businesses, many partnerships are extremely successful and they transcend generations as well. Family businesses, of course, but I've seen numerous, even in our industry and around us, many friends who came together as partners going out 25 years, 30 years, their next generations are getting involved in those businesses and they still run it successfully. So I was wondering what keeps a family business or a business partnership, if you will, together. And I looked around and I found that most of these family businesses have rules which are laid down around money. They have a written constitution. How much can each family member spend? As you make a little bit more money, you turn around and say, okay, shadi ke liye each family member itna deenge. Then kids grow up, you want to say, okay, for education, we'll put money aside for our next generation. We'll put money aside for them to go abroad. So we make rules like this. It's funny, some family businesses in this day and age still have rules that say, let's not involve the wives in the business because the wives can influence the children and that'll cause a split in the family business. I mean, there are still today large families, very well-known families who have this, what I consider stupid rule. I think it's stupid because we're today raising our daughters to be all they can be, right? We're giving them the education, we're giving them opportunity, and even if we are not, their friends are telling them about it and they're watching it on television. So we may think that we're not giving our daughters this kind of exposure, but we completely and totally, they're getting it. So to expect that by keeping half the population away, that's a successful formula, I think it's just short-sighted. So I try to understand what keeps the family business together. Was it all the rules that people put into place? But, you know, I realized that it can't be the rules, right? Because otherwise then you just pick up the rules that a successful family has, and there are a number of them, and copy-paste it for your family, and boom, things should be fine. But it wasn't happening. Same with a partnership. You pick up somebody's partnership deed, take all the rules that they have between them, copy paste it to our partnership deed, and great, business should be awesome. Things should be wonderful, we should have no problems. But that just isn't true. As you think, if you think about it, a family business or a business partnership are two words, right? Family and business, right? And you say business partnership, it's business and partnership. So the one word which is common in both is business. How do you measure business? Profit and loss, money, rupees, paisa, right? It's so simple to measure business. It's so simple to measure success of a business, failure of a business. It's doing well, it's doing badly, you can tell. You read one balance sheet, you read one P&L, and you can tell. So how do you measure the family part of it, or how do you measure the relationship part of it in a business, in the partnership part of it, right? When you've got a partnership which is a relationship, or in a family which is full of relationships, how do you measure that? Love, affection, trust, compassion, empathy? How do you measure that? Is there a scale? There's no scale, there's no score. So you put two words. One is chalk, one is cheese, one is oil, one is water. You put them together, call it a family business, come up with rules which are made from the business part of it, put it onto the family side, and we expect it to work. Same with the partnership. We take a partnership deed, which works very well, to say, this partner will draw out so many lakhs, this will be his salary, this is what we will do, and we set up a business. But the business part of it is covered. What about the partnership? What about the relationship? So I realized that, you know, the measurement of business is easy, the measurement of the family or the partnership is just very hard. The relationship measurement is, there's no score, there's no way to do it. So as I tried to think about what truly keeps these family businesses or business relationships, business partnerships working well, I found that at a cultural level, within the members of that business, be it family business or business partnership, at a cultural level, I've honestly found two things and two things alone. Now, I am on a quest to try and find more. And if I can find more, if somebody here can help me find something more, I'd be delighted. But all I'm going to tell you is share with you my findings so far, which doesn't therefore mean that it's gospel and that is the be-all and end-all. But I'm sure that these two things will certainly help keep those family businesses, members together, and partners of businesses together. So the two things that I found are generosity and communication. Seems like really simple words, right? Generosity and communication. If there's generosity, if there's communication, life is great, move along. Let's just dig a little bit deeper into this. We'll start with communication, right? So a culture of communication within your business, with your partners or with your family members, is about creating a culture of open sharing, giving and receiving feedback, active listening, empathy. If you have something on your mind, you need to have a culture and a space for your family members or partners to be able to speak freely, even though it may seem difficult. Now, I am sure even today, at this very moment, some of you face issues with your partners. This is a real situation with some of you as we speak, right? But if there was a culture where you have an issue, you come and talk about it. If there was a framework where you can come and discuss it openly, right? Imagine that world. The reason why you consider it a burden today is because that culture and that framework to communicate isn't created. So let's move on to generosity. I looked up the definition of generosity, and it's defined as the willingness and liberality in giving one's money, time, etc. So I think generosity needs to be viewed in a much, much larger perspective. I think we need to think about money, of course, right? But at the end of the day, the money is defined by what? The partnership deed, right? Money is defined by those rules that family business consultant came and set up. That's how the money part is defined. So what are you talking about generosity when the rules are there, right? Generosity of money. So let's talk about the other aspects. Material possessions, again, can be covered under rules. Emotions, generosity of love, generosity of understanding, generosity of time. And what I think is a huge one is the generosity of judgmentalism. I'll give you a little example when I talk about generosity and recognizing generosity. In my family, so there's my wife, there's me, there's our daughter. We have one daughter. When she was growing up, like all teenagers, there was a week or a month when she hated both her mother and her father in that same 1 month. Right? And we all have kids. Some of us are lucky if it happens only for 1 week or 1 month. Others go through maybe a year or two of this phase. During the time when my daughter didn't want to speak to me or my wife, I was fortunate that my sister found time for her. Okay? And my sister gave her time for her. Now, it's very easy for me to say, Arish, she's family. It's expected from family. Isme kya badi baat hai? Okay? We can take it for granted. But if we stop for a minute and if we acknowledge that this is what my sister did, and even though my daughter today is 23 and she did this 9 years ago, I'm still talking about it today because I recognize the value of it. So if you recognize the generosity, right? In a partnership firm, for example, you have two partners. One of them is suddenly unwell. What is going to happen? The partner will step in, right? You've got a business meeting, you've got something to do. Even if that partner was going on a holiday, he's going to say, my partner's unwell. It's taam ka sawal hai. Tell the family, sorry, we cannot go, holiday cancelled. I have to be at work. Okay? This is normal. We expect this. We expect this of our partner. But when a partner does it, do we recognize it? Do we acknowledge it? Do we say, I acknowledge the fact that you had to cancel your holiday because I was unwell? Do we acknowledge it? And many of us, unfortunately, don't acknowledge it. We take it for granted. We take it that this is, yaar, partner hai, ye to hota yaar. I would do the same thing for him. Where's the need to say anything about it? Yes, you would do the same thing for him. Yes, if I was ever needed for my sister's daughter, I would be there 200%. But if you acknowledge it, how do they feel about it? And you vocalize it, right? So, when we get into partnerships, we always form a partnership, different from family business. In a family business, they're family members, right? In a partnership, you get together with somebody who brings different strengths and different capabilities to the table from you. That's why you decided to say, chal, let's get together. You see an element of synergy. When they bring that synergy to the table, do we acknowledge it? So, I think generosity is therefore visible with affection, with time, giving advice to your partners, accommodating a partner's request, accommodating a family member's request. That's all forms of generosity. So I gave this talk one time and somebody said, but listen, this is all very well. I keep doing and doing and doing and doing when my bloody brother never reciprocates only. So I said, I agree. I agree that this is a problem. But therefore, I think you need to create a culture. So it's not just about saying, chal, you want something today? Chutti pe jana hai? Theek hai, tu 5 lakh zyada withdraw kar le. It's not about that, right? It's about a culture. And the creating the culture of generosity links back to the other word that I use first, and that's communication. So if we communicate and acknowledge the fact that the person's being generous. If you stop for a second and just think back about the generosity that each of us have received. If it's a family business from our family, right? If it's a business partnership from our business partner. If you stop for a minute and think about it, you will find at least 10 instances. At least 10. And I'm saying 10 instances if your partnership was formed 3 months ago. Which means if you extrapolate it for time, we will find many more such instances. We create the culture by acknowledging it. So if I come and tell you, listen, thanks a lot, you stepped in for me, I felt really relieved, I felt really good, right? You got my back. I feel really good. Thanks so much. That's all. These are obviously your partners. It's over. You've acknowledged it. When you acknowledge it, what ends up happening is you decide along the way that I have to reciprocate this. Right? My partner had my back. Next time, I will have his back because you acknowledge it. You don't have to necessarily communicate it just to your partner. If you communicate it within your family, it creates a different set of impacts within your family as well. So communication of the generosity is very, very critical. We find very often that you're not communicating stuff to your partner. It builds up, it builds up, it builds up, it builds up. One day it just explodes. Whose interest is that in? It's not in your interest. It's not in your partner's interest. It's not in your family's interest. It's not in your business interest. So how do you prevent that? You prevent it by communicating. Now let's look at what happens if you have created a culture of generosity and communication. Right? So we're going to talk to each other with the lenses, if you will, of generosity. So when your partner is going to tell you something which is bothering your partner, and you've acknowledged his generosity in the past, immediately what you're going to hear, you're going to hear his same complaint, you're going to hear the same problem, you're going to hear the same issue. Now you can react from a place of having heard his generosity, and therefore you'll react from generosity. If you have acknowledged it, or if there isn't, you can come back with your own, hey, but last time you did this, the other time you did that. You can escalate it. Approaching that communication from a culture of generosity and creating a culture of that communication automatically leads to both sides engaging in a much more positive, proactive manner. So I don't, you know, is this what I believe, that this is a mantra that will keep all businesses together forever? Certainly not. But I think that if we are accommodative, if we are therefore generous, okay, I think if we are, if we communicate and we communicate actively with empathy, right, putting ourselves in the other person's shoes, I think one thing is for sure, we may choose to go our separate ways, but we'll do it really well. We'll do it in a way where we don't harm each other. We'll do it in a way where we reciprocate for the generosity that that person showed us over the years. And that's in our interest. That's in our selfish interest, to respond in a place and in a manner which doesn't become detrimental to you, to your family, or in courts, or with the police you're fighting, right? The lawyers are making money, right? The taxman is making money. You're unhappy, your family's unhappy. We just don't, you know, you don't want that. So I believe that it's important for families and partners to talk about things in an open and transparent manner. I think it's also important to communicate about your fears openly, your dreams, your ambitions. In my own organization, I've told my team, I have a leadership team who are actually better at their jobs than I can do their jobs. So my CFO is a better CFO than I can be. My head of sales and marketing sells and markets real estate much better than I can. My execution guy constructs better than I can. My only saving grace is, come and sit in my chair for 1 hour. Right? So they cannot come into my chair, so I should not be in a position to sit in their chair. Now, in that open, transparent communication, there was a time when I wasn't letting go as much as they wanted me to let go. And they said, boss, what's going on here? Why are you not, you know, you seem to have a problem. You seem to be concerned about something. And I opened up and I communicated to them. And I said, you know what? I have been let down by so many people in these senior positions before you guys, right, that I feel really scared. to let go, because I let go, I've given up authority, control, you guys don't take full ownership, then you walk away, I'm left cleaning up the crap, because the only person who's left here to clean up everything after everybody's gone is the entrepreneur. And that is me. Right? So therefore I said, look, let's communicate. And when you start communicating like that in an open manner about your deep fears with your partners to start, I went a step further and told my team, but if you tell your partners that, straight away, their response was, why don't you try us out? Tell us what you want step by step for you to get the confidence in us. And we will prove to you that we're not like the others who've been here before. And they did. And they did. So how does one, and the other thing, you know, I mean, it's interesting, it's really important, right? We all have different life experiences. You take a pair of twins, identical twins. Talk to them when they're 30 and 20. Even they will have different life experiences. Even their persona, their character will be different. Every person has a different life experience, right? And therefore, we have to understand that even these twins will react differently. So we have to have generosity even when they react with us. So the question is, this is what somebody asked me, and I'm just preempting that because we'll get to the Q&A bit in about a minute. How do we start this? Sounds very nice. How do I get going with it? Right? And I'll tell you what I did in my family. I decided long ago with my brother that we won't settle small accounts. Then I told my dad, I said, you know what, these small things don't worry about. And then we started acknowledging that generosity. And anyone can do it. It doesn't have to be the senior most, it doesn't have to be the eldest, it can be the youngest, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter where you are. The moment you start acknowledging that generosity to your partners, to your family members, I think you'll start realizing that they'll suddenly say, oh, that's pretty cool. They'll hear it one time, they'll hear it second time, they'll hear it a third time. Before the fourth time, they'll acknowledge something about you. So the last thing I'm going to say is this, that I think family businesses, I think these partnerships, right, are eventually the ultimate form of insurance. It's the ultimate form of insurance. Because if something is to happen to the entrepreneur, who will step in to take care of that business, resolve things for the family of that entrepreneur who was, I don't know, affected, hit by a bus, passed away, whatever, right? Hit by a calamity. Who will step in? In the case of the family business, it's the family members. And in the case of a partnership, it's the partners. So in that sense, this is the ultimate form of insurance. And therefore, isn't it in our own best self-interest to ensure that insurance policy, if nothing else, that insurance policy is strong, functioning really well, so that in that 0.001% chance that we are the guy who has to, where the life insurance has to actually be encashed, right? That at least those partners, those family members will be that true bond and strength as far as your family members are concerned. If for nothing else, at least for that selfish reason, I think everybody of us needs to focus on generosity, acknowledging generosity, communicating it, having an open communication, so that we end up with a far, far better, in a sense, longer duration kind of partnership with whoever we're partnering with. Thank you very much.